back to the year 1979. That's a year when personal computers were in their infancy, and many people affectionately called them trash 80s. Coincidentally, that same year is also the year that the Modbus protocol was invented. I can only imagine, probably they were sitting around a table, maybe scrawling things on napkins. Would they have ever imagined that we would be using Modbus protocol 44 years later to control critical infrastructure? The stark reality here is that secure comms is still a ways away. As vendors, we're committed. We need secure protocols, secure Modbus, the list goes on. But again, we're not going to get that deployed and adopted within the industry this year. It may take a number of years, right? And we need security today. So in the innovation lab at Schneider, one of the things we started looking at is what can we do to kind of close the gap? Let's raise that security posture with current industry protocols like Modbus, DMP3, et cetera. And we kind of stumbled on something, so we're bringing this to the community, asking, are we on the right track here, or are we crazy? Looking at this from a systems level approach may give us the ability to leverage some data that to this point has been unleveraged to secure our systems. So let's look at the traditional approach that we have today and how we secure these systems. It's really a castle approach, right? We look at the perimeter, we secure the perimeter, let's have a nice firewall there, that's appropriate. But then what if an attacker breaches within our industrial control system? They can typically make lateral movement. That's a problem. Now, thankfully, we've advanced to the point to where now we'll see a more defense-in-depth approach, which is appropriate, that's great. So now we'll have firewalls at different levels in the architecture, maybe even have those firewalls in the switchgear, right? So if they were to have some type of a breach at a higher level, lateral movement would be fettered. It would be harder to get to. In some of those more advanced systems, we'll even see a secured VPN. So from the control room down to the switchgear, let's encrypt that traffic. Again, that's an appropriate way to do it. Sure, add that encryption. But again, these are stopgap measures, right? And just like something I'm going to present today could be considered a stopgap measure. So what we were looking at as a team, again, we kind of had the innovation team looking at this and saying, well, if we're not going to have secure comms for a couple of years, what can we do today, again, to bring up a security posture? And we recognized that there is a trove of data in our OT network that is going untapped. So let's take a step back and think about the IT network. An IT network, it's very hard to determine what an anomaly is, right? And you also have endpoints that are being connected and disconnected. Think about it in your workforce, when they arrive at the facility, they're all connecting Wi-Fi, and now you have a return of 100, 200, 1,000 endpoints now connected to your IT network. Compare that to OT. It's a flat network. We know what devices are on the OT network. We know about relays and circuit breakers, power meters, PLCs, etc. And that SCADA system knows even more than we do about it. It is literally the single source of truth. That SCADA system knows about every device on your OT network, and we're guaranteed it's not stale, because if it was stale data, if it was incorrect, SCADA system wouldn't work, right? So can we take that data, that trove of data, and leverage it to bring further security posture to today's networks that currently have insecure protocols? And we think, again, we may have figured out a way to do it. So let's use a very simple use case. Let's talk about if we could take the data, have a secure comms layer just for the configuration of these firewalls, of these OT firewalls. To be clear, we're still sending Modbus TCP, still sending the normal traffic that we've sent for the last 44 years across this network. But in this case, could we securely configure the firewalls only to allow traffic when absolutely necessary? So let's look at the first use case. The first use case would be something like a maintenance window. So for those of you very familiar with SCADA, you might want to ignore me for 30 seconds, but for those of you not familiar with this maintenance window theory or technique, circuit breakers have to be maintained. Okay, so when we're talking about intelligent breakers like in medium voltage, high voltage installations, we're not talking about circuit breakers like in your home. These circuit breakers have a counter that every time they get opened or tripped or closed, it increments that counter. And once you get to a specific point, you have to service the breaker. That might be some type of lubrication, it might be some type of update to the device, but bottom line, you have to enter into a maintenance window so that you can rack the breaker out, pull it out of the switchgear, do whatever that service is, and then you place it back into service. Well, when you enter that maintenance window, you go to the SCADA system and you say, this device is in maintenance mode. What that tells the SCADA system is, we're going to ignore the alarms. So anything that's coming from the device in service, or that's in a service mode, a maintenance mode, we don't care about it because likely it's related to that maintenance window. What a better time for an attacker to come into a system when the SCADA system's literally ignoring any anomalies and any alarms in the system. So, what if we tweak the SCADA now to where when we say enter maintenance mode for either an area of our plant or even a specific device, let's send a secure configuration signal down to the firewall that's responsible for protecting that part of the infrastructure, and let's wall it off. Let's sandbox it down. So a bit of a strategy change, right? Most of the time, for context, when these firewalls are deployed, they're commissioned, they're configured, and they run on that same configuration month after month, year after year. We're looking at configuring this stuff on the fly. So again, pretty simple use case. So we thought, okay, if we can do this, let's look at a little bit more complex use case. So we're talking about complex data acquisition. Let me back up a bit and give you a bit of a preview of or some knowledge on how some of our devices, circuit breakers, and power meters work so you understand what I mean by this complex data acquisition. These intelligent breakers, intelligent power meters, they're looking at the electrical signal, and when something happens on the network, let's say it's an overcurrent condition or maybe a lightning strike, whatever the case is, it works like a DVR. It literally backs up in time because it's collected all of these values frequently, like every 100 milliseconds, for instance, and it says, this is what happened before, during, and after the event, and then the SCADA system can pull that in, potentially even with a waveform capture, and see like the oscilloscope sinusoidal wave on a viewer so that you can help detect what happened in the system. It's not just a couple of little readings. We're downloading files from these devices when an event happens. But here's the key. We only need that data when an event occurs. If we deploy an OT firewall with deep packet inspection, we have to open the deep packet inspection so wide because we have to also be able to get to this complex data when and if it occurs. In other words, we're unnecessarily widening the gap and potentially allowing attackers traffic to memory addresses of our gear that's simply not necessary. So, let's go through a use case where we could apply that same logic as we did for the maintenance window, but do it for complex data acquisition. So to do this, you have to understand a bit about how the memory is set up inside of these devices. First of all, it's generally separated into three areas. You have frequent access. So that's where the SCADA system is saying in a pole, in a constant loop, what's the voltage, what's the voltage, what's the voltage? It keeps asking every couple of hundred milliseconds to every 15 minutes or 10 minutes, depending on what the value or what the quantity you're looking for and what region you're in the world. There's different standards for that. But bottom line, it's always asking for these values. Those are the frequent access areas. Then we have the occasional access. That's what we just talked about. If something bad happens, we're gonna put a record in this area to give more detail for a forensic analysis, okay? That's occasional access. And then finally, we have the very sensitive area of the device, the rare access area, that's the configuration data. This is where the trip curve resides. So if an attacker gains access to this area, they can potentially change an alarm threshold, change the trip curve, create an unsafe condition. We have to completely monitor and secure that area of memory, okay? Let's go through the use case of that alarm. So, in this case, we're gonna wall off with the OT firewall, we're gonna wall off all of the area of memory from the circuit breaker except those frequently accessed areas, okay? We're gonna trigger an alarm. Conveniently, when you trigger an alarm or when an alarm occurs on one of these devices, It also sets a flag in the frequently accessed register memory space. It increments a counter every time an alarm is triggered. And we're reading that value all the time from the SCADA. So that tells the SCADA that there's a new alarm. It doesn't tell it what the alarm is. It just tells it that there's a new alarm. The SCADA is then going to make a request for the alarm record that we currently have in that secured area that's not available. But at this point, the SCADA has a secure connection to the configuration of the firewall. So it can configure the firewall on the fly to open up that area of memory for access by the SCADA, read the alarm record back, and then as you can imagine, what are we gonna do next? We're gonna lock it back down, right? So this is just a dynamic way to configure the firewall so that we don't have to open up more than necessary at any given time. It all sounds good in theory. We started this whole adventure about 3 years ago. Again, our innovation lab, we got a couple of people together and said, again, it's gonna take too long for secure comms. We've gotta do something now. How can we raise the security posture? Came up with this idea, started working with all these OT firewall vendors to see if there's a way we could pull this off for a proof of concept. And we learned a lot. What we learned was that firewalls are architecturally different from other network security appliances in that they're not designed to be reconfigured on the fly constantly. And you'll probably recognize that if you've configured a firewall recently. It's architecturally appropriate, but what it does is it downloads the entire configuration, you change something, it runs it through a validation stage, again, necessary and appropriate, and then it uploads the configuration to commit to a firewall. For us, we couldn't get that under 2 minutes, meaning that if an alarm triggered on the device, it would take 2 minutes to recommit the firewall and finally get the alarm back to the SCADA system, completely blowing our timing way out. There's no way that we could accept, nor could our customers accept that timing. So we shelved it. At this point, we thought, yeah, this isn't gonna work. Sat on it, I don't know, maybe 6 months, a year, and we were at S4 last year, and we met up with TX1, and they had an IPS, intrusion prevention system, and my initial thought was, oh yeah. IPS and the critical infrastructure, wait, we don't go there. Intrusion detection system, maybe, but yeah, there's this position again. Yeah, IPS and critical infrastructure, that's scary. But I gave it a shot, and we started looking at the architecture of this IPS, and we thought, whoa, wait a second, that might be exactly what we need. So I want you to think about what an IPS does. An IPS is sitting on a network. For the most part, it's open, right? It's allowing traffic, and it's looking for anomalies on the network, and if it senses an anomaly, it locks itself down. It prevents the data from flowing if it senses an anomaly, and it does that as quickly as possible because it thinks it's under current attack. Well, what if we were to flip that on its head and we were to say, no, we don't want you to stay open. We want you to stay closed by default. Let's block all the traffic you possibly can. And then when we send you a signal that we're about to send something in the clear, we want you to open for just that very one specific message. And we found out in our proof of concept that this IPS device could reconfigure itself in 50 milliseconds. Now we're in business. So we start really brainstorming like, oh wow, like originally we thought this was gonna be maintenance windows and maybe download some complex data. But for us at least, this was like the holy grail. Because now we can have Modbus with real-time access, we get the real-time data, we get the alarms, and we can protect the control operations. We can protect against adversaries, attackers that are trying to get into our system from opening and closing relays and circuit breakers. That's a big deal. Let's walk through how this proof of concept works. Give you a bit of a kind of lay the land here. We have a piece of switchgear locked in closure. That's an important point. You have to have a secured enclosure for this to work because everything behind the firewall or the IPS, as the case may be, it's still raw Modbus. So we depend on physical security. In energy management, that's pretty natural for us because we're typically deployed in switchgear, metal clad switchgear, something along those lines, or it could be in a secure room, right? In this case, if we use an example of an IT firewall, which I'm sure all of you are familiar with, I'm going to keep it simple here. It's just port and IP address. Now, I know there's application-based IT firewalls that can do deep packet inspection. That's great. That's not what we're focused on here. I want you to compare this IT firewall with an OT firewall. With an OT firewall, we can do true deep packet inspection. In this case, we're saying we're only going to allow traffic on port 1101, and we're only going to allow write-only traffic. Pretty specific. Notice to close these breakers, I gave you a little footnote up there. To close that breaker, you have to write a 1 to register address 1101. So we can tighten this down with an OT firewall. But remember, we can't wait 2 minutes to pull this off. We've got to get to the 50 milliseconds. That's where we get to the IPS, where we add a couple of other columns. You see that? So we have port, IP, register with operation, the value that we're sending to the register, and account. We want to make sure that we're not susceptible to replay attacks. We're going to make this a one shot. Let's go through the use case. So I want to close a circuit breaker. I'm going to click the close button on the SCADA system. The first thing I'm going to do is establish a secure communications link between the SCADA and the IPS device. I'm going to send, again, in 50 milliseconds, it'll do the commit. I'm going to send it a command that says, I'm about to send a Modbus message, and this is exactly what I'm about to send. But I'm doing all this configuration over a secure link from the SCADA to the switchgear. After I have received a response from the IPS that says, I'm ready, I committed the change, then I send the true Modbus. Okay? So Modbus TCP, the same Modbus we've used for 44 years, it's getting sent from the SCADA all the way through the switchgear, it hits the breaker closes. The IPS, remember that was a one-shot, notice the count. Count's decremented to a zero. It saw the traffic, it allows the acknowledgement back to the SCADA, no problem. It erases the rule, the IPS is locked back down. Notice there's no element of time here. In other words, we're not opening the fire or the IPS here and then allowing traffic and then closing it back down. That's not it at all. We're telling the TX1 IPS to only allow that one message through, lock itself back down. So let's look at this, and by the way, as I mentioned, we're doing that in 100 milliseconds. So if you were to take the latency from the SCADA to the device and measure that, and then inject this technique, we're adding 100 milliseconds to that. Keep in mind, this is 100 milliseconds from a user-triggered click event to the time the device closes. This doesn't affect any protection profiles or anything like that, because all of that's typically within the locked enclosure, within the switchgear. So let's look at the same use case with what I think is a pretty interesting attacker attempt. So in this case, the attacker is sending a flood of messages, and it's a closed command, coincidentally, and they are spoofing the SCADA system. So they're spoofing the IP of the SCADA. Got it? That's our effect here. So we're injecting a flood of closed commands, and we are legitimately going to try to close the breaker with the SCADA system. So going through the same case as before, the first thing that's going to happen is we're going to click the close button. The operator clicks the close button in the SCADA system. It sends the secure traffic over to the IPS. It says this is the exact Modbus message that is about to be sent. Be ready for it. The IPS responds and says, yep, I'm committed. I'm ready. Now what happens? We've got a race condition, right? Because we're going to send Modbus traffic to close the breaker, and the attacker is also flooding the network with that same message. So which one's going to arrive first to the IPS? In all likelihood, it's going to be the attacker's traffic that's going to do that. Likely, the traffic that we send legitimately from the SCADA system is going to be discarded, because the attacker's traffic got through because it matched the signature that we had prepared the IPS for in the previous step. The attacker's traffic gets through the IPS, and what does it do? It closes the breaker. The IPS doesn't know it's not from the SCADA, but here's the here's the key, it really doesn't care. Because all the Modbus is acting as is a trigger at this point. We've told the IPS over the secure link what command we want to execute on the switchgear. We've effectively created a finite state machine between the SCADA and the circuit breaker and the switchgear, the devices behind the IPS. So the output matches our intended operation. Another way to say this is effectively the attacker did us a favor. Think about the acknowledgement. The acknowledgement, they spoofed the IP address of the SCADA, so where's the acknowledgement going to come back to? The actual SCADA. The SCADA is completely unaware that it wasn't the one that performed the operation. Now hopefully you have an IDS somewhere up in a higher level of your architecture that notices there's a flood of nefarious data on your network, but bottom line, your control system remains unaffected. A couple of closing thoughts here. We've been given this demo for the past 2.5 days and got some cool response on it. Had some great questions. Got a couple of minutes left. I'll cover a couple of those questions. The first one is, does it only support Modbus? Absolutely not. It supports any protocol that both the IPS device and the SCADA system both support. That could be DMP3, Modbus, 61850, the list goes on. So as long as you have the support at the IPS and at the SCADA, you're good to go. From a commissioning point of view, there's a question of, do you have to configure the IPS for all of that gear behind the IPS? Think about where the IPS is positioned. It's positioned just inside of the switchgear. You could have one relay, you could have 100 relays, and 50 circuit breakers inside of that same switchgear. These devices are running at 400 megabits per second. That's way beyond the bandwidth requirements for ICS systems, right? So it scales pretty well. When you add devices to your SCADA system, the way you do that normally is you add a device profile, like pick the model of the device you're adding, you add an IP address for that device. In this technique, you would also add the IP address of the IPS that it's sitting behind. And that would be the deployment mechanism. Because at that point, all of that data in the SCADA system, it has everything it needs to know to craft these signatures to send to the IPSs. I think finally I want to give you a call to action. It's a pretty simple one. I think it's a powerful one though. And that is, I want you to hold us accountable as vendors. As you know, we're a business. And in business, we have to justify development for our products. Includes security posture, security features, etc. By you demanding security features in our products to us, that helps us build a business case to justify that development. We need that. We need you to when you spec in product, require those products to meet a standard, 62443, for instance. Require your system deployments to meet 62443. That helps us as a vendor, and it absolutely helps your systems raise their security posture. We have a demo of this. I'm going to go up to the room here in a few minutes. It's up on the third floor in the Schneider room. It's a live demo. We can dig into the nuts and bolts behind this. I would love to answer any questions you have on it. I literally coded some of this last week. Like, we can get down into the code. I don't care. I want to show you how this works and see if this fits in your environment and get feedback from you if we're on the right track. And with that, I appreciate your time. Thank you.